This film is brought to you by New York Life and its dedicated agents. Proud sponsors of the NFL's team highlight films. New York Life, the company you keep.
You gotta hang loose, you gotta go 100 miles an hour.
So right here, right now, we made our fellas. Take no crap.
Come on, baby.
Let's be somebody.
Come on. We're in for a dogfight.
This is what you wait your entire adult life for, right here. Get the feeling running down your arms, into your fingers. This is what life's all about.
Let's be special. Be special. That's us.
And I guess it's safe to say that anything might happen today because it's all happening.
When the Atlanta Falcons took the field in 1991, anything could, and most often did, happen.
Get the ball! Get the ball!
He is just maybe the finest all-around athlete that's playing the game today.
45-50, Deion, 100 yards! Touchdown, Deion Sanders!
You seen this guy dance? This is the number one dancer in the world.
Have some fun, huh? Let's have some fun.
The Falcons had their fun, but they also had a serious side.
Crank your up! Come on, come on! Knock the ball out! Come on! Come on!
Whether they were flooring opponents or shaking their stuff on NFL dance floors, these good guys in black took the needed steps to become a legitimate playoff contender. They went from 5 wins in 1990 to 11 in 91. But more important, they never quit. They never stopped dancing. 5 times they came from behind to win games, often saving their most miraculous moves for last.
We're going Hail Mary. There goes Tolliver. A long, high pass down in the corner, batted. They fight. Touchdown!
They're not the best team in football yet. But they are the most exciting, because in 1991, they were too legit. Well, you tell them, Hammer. Maybe it was opening day jitters, but in Kansas City, the Falcons were the ones who looked nervous and scared. 6 turnovers and just 3 points had them asking themselves questions.
What's wrong with this?
Things didn't get much better in week 2. The Falcons had hoped for smooth sailing in the home opener, but the prettiest flights and most polished landings were chartered by Vikings.
So Wade Wilson sprints back to throw, and he's going to throw a long bomb, and a one-handed grab.
While some were impressed with their opponent's aerial acrobatics, others simply wanted Atlanta's offense to get off the ground.
Miller going to take it and look, and going for the corner, touchdown!
Chris Miller did throw a pair of scoring strikes, but he and his teammates came up a point short. And if they were going to prevent this from being a long season, they'd have to win on the road, something they hadn't done in 19 tries. Year man Steve Broussard eclipsing the 100-yard barrier for the first time in his career, and rookie Mike Pritchard scoring his first NFL touchdown, the young Falcons captured their first win in 91.
Fires. Pritchard, a great grab, 10-5 in the corner, touchdown.
But if the Falcons were going to compete with the toughest teams in the NFL, this youthful squad was going to have to mature in a real hurry.
You Falcons!
Go Falcons!
Hungry for an opportunity to prove they could handle one of the league's big boys, the Falcons spent the afternoon showing the Raiders who was the baddest team in black. Atlanta roughed up the Raiders on both sides of the ball. It was a performance which would have made both professional wrestlers and professional dancers proud. Atlanta body slammed and slam danced all afternoon as both the Fulton County faithful and the Red Gun offense grooved to a winning beat.
Position to the other side. Fake. Bootleg left. Miller. And he's going to throw it to Broussard. Touchdown! Raiders got five on the line. Miller back. Looks. Going to throw a long lead pattern to Haynes. Touchdown!
Chris Miller and the offense finally had reason to celebrate, but the biggest play in this game was made by the defense.
We're coming on him. They hit him. There's a fumble. We pick it up. Touchdown! Touchdown!
Jesse Tuggle helped Atlanta improve to 2-2 and showed that despite an ugly start, the Falcons were capable of busting a winning move. For 2 years, he's led the NFL in tackles, but instead of being the most heralded linebacker in football, Jesse Tuggle is the most underrated. He always makes the play.
There, right over the middle, and they hit him and he fumbled.
Yet rarely gets the glory.
Picked up by Tippins, the 15, the 10, the 5, Tippins.
Tuggle led a linebacking crew, which included Ken Tippins, Michael Reed, Robert Lyles, John Rady, and Darian Connor. Since his arrival in Atlanta, Jerry Glanville has preached and promised an all-out attack defense. He has kept his word. And as a result, opponents have begun to lose their heads.
Adjust!
With Rick Bryan, Mike Gann, Oliver Barnett, Torrey Epps, Defensive Rookie of the Year Mo Gardner, and team sack leader Tim Green constantly swarming to the ball. Glanville's gang-tackling black wave has impressed and imprisoned enemy after enemy. Hoping to smash apart its enemy in Week 7, Atlanta traveled to San Francisco and lowered the
boom
on the 49ers by detonating a highly explosive offense.
The left, looking, there's Rison, touchdown in the corner. Rison came across the middle, went in the left corner, they beat the free safety. Miller back to throw, and he's going to throw a lead pass to Haynes. Touchdown!
Michael Haynes and Andre Rison combined for 3 scores, and a man who high steps it better than anyone in the game went coast to coast as Atlanta beat its third West Coast team in 3 tries.
15 to the 20, the 25 to the 30, 35 to the 40, 45, 50. Deion, 100 yards. Touchdown, Deion Sanders.
Man, what an athlete.
Deion Sanders' 100-yard score undoubtedly surprised San Francisco, but the fourth quarter performance of ex-49er Tim McCaier must have shocked them. Earlier in the week, McCaier had predicted a late interception. Reality was even better than fantasy, though, as McCaier picked off a pair to help the Falcons improve to 3-3. McCaier was the newest member of Atlanta's secondary, a fierce foursome that epitomized Falcon football. It was a quartet that hit hard, had fun, and got the job done.
Win, baby, win.
We gotta give these guys a message, man, right off the bat.
They're doing win.
Give them a message. Win. 1, 2, 3, win.
Come on, BJ, let's go, Brian Jordan!
Safeties Brian Jordan and Scott Case combined for 307 punishing tackles. And McCaier tied with All-Pro corner Sanders for the most interceptions in the NFC with 6. Whether pounding opponents or picking off passes, Atlanta's secondary was able to combine the perfect mixture of ferocity with fun. The commissioner couldn't have picked a more exciting time to learn the finer points of Falcon football. The Atlanta Braves had the city in a tomahawk-chopping October rage, and the Atlanta Falcons caught the fever by throwing 3 home run balls against the Rams.
Look and look and throws in the end zone. Touchdown! Miller back, looking, and there goes Haynes, coming open, complete touchdown!
Ball perfectly thrown.
Miller, coming back, stops, and throws, there he is, touchdown Rising!
With Chris Miller enjoying the most accurate passing day of his career, Atlanta chopped its way through the Rams and prepared for another battle with the 49ers.
War. This will be a war.
Wars with the 49ers were nothing new for Mike Ken, the only current Falcon who had beaten San Francisco twice in the same season.
Beating them twice, beating the 49ers? I sure hope so, man. That'd be great. That'd be great. I don't know how long it's been since they've done that around here.
11 years. But on a day when football seemed to materialize out of the sky and land exactly where the Falcons wanted, there was that funny feeling it could happen again, just as long as the defense stayed organized.
We got one, and I see the slot where I'm usually going radar, but at 35 is to the backside like he was on you. I'm going to forget the radar, and I'm going to play more in the middle, and I'm going to help you on the deep stuff.
By helping each other with the likes of Jerry Rice and John Taylor, the Black Wave held the 49ers to a single touchdown through three quarters. The only problem was that the Falcons were being shut out. Still, they would not quit.
Too legit to quit! Too legit to quit!
Even after they had lost Chris Miller to injuries.
Tolliver backs up and throws the Rising on the goal line. Touchdown!
It's tie score now. We move it on. We roll it on. We roll it on.
It's the playoffs.
This is us.
It's all right. It's the playoffs.
In a game that had all the intensity of the playoffs,
they count now. They count now, baby.
Atlanta's special teams made a playoff-caliber play.
Take it, fumble on the 29. It's fumbled again. Pick it up. And the Falcons have got the ball. Tracy Johnson down around the 15.
That's a lot of time on that clock, too. If we make it, they still got two minutes and 43 seconds on, baby. Get it, baby.
Set down, and the kick is up, and the kick is good. Now it's 10-7.
Norm Johnson had given Atlanta a three-point lead with a little over 2 minutes to go. But against the 49ers, that's never enough. And if the Falcons were going to complete the sweep, they'd have to reach deep into their bag or bucket of tricks. Billy Joe Tolliver led Atlanta to the 49ers 44. And then it was time for a play he had perfected in practice. A play simply known as Big Ben.
Well, stranger things have happened. The Falcons have hit two of them in the past. 9 seconds. We overload. Three to the right. Trips are on the right. We're going Hail Mary. There goes Tolliver. A long, high pass. Down in the corner. Batted. They fight. Touchdown! Touchdown! Touchdown!
Oh, my gosh!
That couldn't have happened. Ungodly. My God, somebody caught the ball. Who caught it?
Haynes.
It's Michael Haynes. I can't believe that happened. That couldn't have happened.
I said somebody catch it. I closed my eyes. They said, I heard a crowd yelling.
Too legit to quit. Too legit. Too legit to quit.
The sweep was complete. Glanville's Two Live crew was too legit. And they more than proved that in a Week 12 hammering of Tampa Bay.
Well, they got him. Gardner got him. It's picked up by Barnett over the 45, the 50. Oliver Barnett down the long left side. Barnett, touchdown.
Mo Gardner and Oliver Barnett teamed for one score, and Chris Miller and Andre Rison connected three times in a club-record 33-point second quarter.
He's going to lob open. Touchdown, Rison.
The Falcons were 6-5 as they headed to New Orleans for a matchup with the division leaders. And behind an offensive line of men like Jamie Dukes, Houston Hoover, Mike Ken, Mike Ruther, Joe Sims, Bill Frelich, and Chris Hinton, Chris Miller and Michael Haynes were able to air it out all night long.
One running back, Miller back, looking, and he's going to throw, and he's got Michael Haynes, touchdown!
Haynes caught six balls for a pair of scores and nearly 200 yards, and although his teammates got tired just watching him run, he kept going deep.
Well, man, you got to take some chances, you know, you got to take some chances, you want to make plays.
Miller back in the end zone looking. And he's going to throw a long pass to Michael Haynes. And it is complete.
sweep down.
Haynes' overtime catch gave Norm Johnson, who didn't miss a field goal under 45 yards all year, a chance to win it with a 50-yarder.
Tie ball game. We're in overtime. Bullhead gonna hold it, sets it up, and the kick is reaching close, and it is good. He just got it in there. Norm Johnson hit it. Long, long field goal. It is sudden death.
Once again, the special teams had come through to help provide a too legit come-from-behind miracle. And the following week against Green Bay, the routine continued.
High kickoff, Norm Johnson, high and deep, goal line. Now the defense has to do something. And we strip the ball.
Albert Shelley gave the Falcons some life, and Chris Miller, who Jerry Glanville said looked like death with a 103-degree fever, rallied the Falcons to 3 touchdowns in the last 10 minutes.
Miller back, right down the middle to Rising. Touchdown! Hurry up, you guys. Takes the snap, Miller does, and looks, and down the middle. Touchdown! 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 He hit Rising with 41 seconds.
Call it what you will, the Falcons were finding ways to win. And at 8-5 were very much alive for a playoff spot. Some retrievers and some receivers can flat out go and get it.
Miller takes and decides to throw a bomb, and Haynes, touchdown!
And in 1991, no one went and got it like Michael Haynes. In his fourth year, Haynes averaged an NFL high 22.4 yards per catch and had a dozen plays over 30 yards.
Miller back, a long lead pattern. Michael Haynes down the sideline. Michael Haynes, touchdown in the corner.
Got to get 80 the ball, though. Keep him happy.
Number 80 Andre Rison is happiest when he is extremely involved in the offense. And through his first 3 seasons, he's been rather involved. With 81 catches in 91, Rison established an NFL record for the most receptions in the first 3 years of a career with 215.
And looks, and looks, and looks, and now he's gonna throw! Touchdown!
Boy, that was a pretty pass.
Chris Miller also threw some pretty passes to rookie Mike Pritchard, who had 50 receptions, and the versatile Deion Sanders. Miller earned his first Pro Bowl berth by throwing for over 3,100 yards and 26 touchdowns. And he also led all quarterbacks, averaging over 7 yards per rush. But in week 15, he didn't have to run too much. He just kept throwing to the receiving pair that combined for 23 touchdowns, the most by a duo in the NFL. By defeating the Rams, the Falcons completed a 6-0 record against California teams, and they returned home to pick on another West Coast team in the final game ever at Fulton County Stadium. In this battle of the birds, the Falcons ruled the roost.
Stauffer on second down is back and looking. Stauffer in trouble, and we're gonna get him in the end zone, safety.
It was a day when every aspect of the Falcons' attack was executed to perfection.
Gonna throw a bomb to a man in the corner. Touchdown!
Although the entire team was making this a memorable last home game, you didn't even have to uncover your binoculars to see who the star of this affair was. Primetime saved his best for last by picking off 2 passes. And since he was so gracious laterally to Tim McKeyer, it seemed only fitting McKeyer returned the favor.
Craig, the quarterback, he comes back to throw from the end zone, a bomb. A long bomb, not thrown well. McKeyer intercepts on the 50. McKeyer gives it to Deion. 50, 45, 40, 35, 30, 25, 20, 10. In the corner, touchdown, Deion.
They started the season 0-2. Now they were too legit, headed for the playoffs and the talk of the league.
You got to give Atlanta a lot of credit.
They
play a different style of football, but boy, they get it. They play.
That guy's a hell of a coach.
They play.
Yeah.
I know all about
him. Yeah, you know him. Yeah, no, he's a good coach.
They live on the edge, but they play hard.
And they just don't talk about what they're going to do. That's what they do.
That's right. Everybody knows it.
I went in their locker room yesterday. You couldn't believe the racket and noise. My ears were.
I think it'd be the noisiest playoff game ever. History of playoffs, so make some noise. Hope they can boo real good.
Lose or go home. I don't want to go home. Not right now.
You people got to make something happen. We got to find out what we are. Let's go. 1, 2, 3. Hit the beast!
Take it and come back and look. There he is. Touchdown, Rison, right down the middle. He hit Andre Rison.
After falling behind by 10 points in their first playoff game in 9 years, the Falcons fought back by doing what they did all season, getting the ball to Andre Rison and Michael Haynes.
They can't stop all of this, man. Need a touchdown. Need a touchdown, man.
Miller gonna throw a lead pattern in the corner, and it is touchdown right in the corner. Michael Haynes, a fantastic catch with two men on.
While the Red Gun was abusing the league's number two ranked defense, the Black Wave was giving much abuse to the Saints offense. Atlanta's defense kept the game close by stuffing Saints and stealing balls, but you must realize by now that Falcons style requires a dramatic last minute win. Could this game end any other way?
Big play, we're ahead. The ball's all over with. We'll be on our way.
And the Saints are in a 4-3. Miller gonna take it, go to the sideline to Haynes, who ran around the man to 45, the 40, the 35, the 30, the 25. Haynes, touchdown, Michael Haynes. But God, there's an hour to play.
It just seemed that long. Actually, it was under 3 minutes, and typical of the Falcons, the secondary had a grand time killing the clock.
Intercepted, McKyer intercepted on the 31. He's running up the middle. He wants the lateral. He does to Deion, who's in trouble. Deion trying to go back.
Maybe they should have fallen on the ball, but that's not the Falcons' way. That's not attacking football. That's not fun football.
Deion 45, and he laterals. We lateral and we lateral. Deion. McKyer, we got guys all over the field sitting on top of each other.
The touchdown didn't count, but it hardly mattered.
Number one right here, baby. We're so exciting. Boy, everybody needs to watch our show. See ya. Falcons are rolling.
The Falcons show rolled no further, but they got their message across in 91. 2 years ago, they stumbled to 3 wins. Now they can dance with anybody. They find ways to win, and in 92, in their new Georgia Dome, it will continue because the Falcons are too legit to quit.
Hi, I'm Steve Sable. As you've just seen, the Atlanta Falcons are one of the most exciting teams in the National Football League. And in 1992, they could be one of the most successful. They have speed all over the field, an aggressive defense that likes to take chances, and an explosive offense. And in the recent draft, they added two first-round picks, Stanford's All-American tackle, Bob Whitfield, and Southern Mississippi running back, Tony Smith, who should help put a lot of points on the Falcons' new indoor scoreboard. So let's take a look at these Falcons, who've decided to fly their Fulton County coupe for the comforts of a dome.
This is the way the game's supposed to be. In the mud and the slush, the cold. Didn't Johnny Cash write a song about this or something?
When the Atlanta Falcons take the field in 1992, they won't have to worry about any foul weather. The Falcons have moved their nest from Fulton County Stadium to the soon-to-be-completed Georgia Dome. Now, there's no telling how Jerry Glanville's squad will play under their new roof, but there's no doubt that this bunch will be versatile.
Ruth, now, you be center, you're left guard, or we'll move over to the right guard, or come over and be tight end.
What about quarterback?
Quarterback if things go bad.
From Pop Warner leagues to the pros, it seems everyone wants to be quarterback. In Atlanta, that job belongs to Pro Bowler Chris Miller. Miller enters his sixth season as Atlanta's signal caller after having led the Falcons to the playoffs in 1991. With the receiving crew he'll be throwing to, expect to see Atlanta in postseason play again. A nice addition to the Red Gun offense will be Houston Oilers' all-time leading receiver, Drew Hill. Hill caught 90 passes last year and should complement quite nicely the man who led the NFL in yards per catch, Michael Haynes.
Miller takes it, he's coming back to throw, and decides to throw a bomb, and Haynes, touchdown! Haynes beat his...
A lot of fast guys can catch the ball and get out of bounds. He catches the ball and gets it downfield.
Haynes got the ball down the field for over 1,100 yards, and teamed with All-Pro Andre Rison to create more than their share of last-minute magic for the Falcons.
Doing it at a crucial time is what he wants to do. So when the game's on the line, if I'm going to call an offensive play, I'm really technical, I say, get the ball to Rison.
Miller going to take it. Floats to the right, fires, and touchdown, Rison.
Atlanta definitely will continue to get the ball to Rison. But if the Falcons are going to creep closer to a Super Bowl berth, they'll have to improve their running game. Number 41, Eric Pegram, should help that cause. Pegram enters his second season after a solid rookie year, and he'll join Steve Broussard, who led the team in rushing last year.
Second down outside of the 5-yard line, and we give it to Broussard, and touchdown!
In 1991, Atlanta finished fifth in the league in scoring. This is an offense that no doubt is ready for prime time. The Falcons may have the most versatile player in the league in Deion Sanders, who teamed with Tim McCaire for a dozen interceptions last year. And Atlanta also may have the toughest, Jesse Tuggle.
Jesse's the best linebacker in football, and he's one of the few linebackers, regardless of down and distance, never leaves the game. He doesn't come out in the long yardage. He doesn't come out in the nickel, the dime, the goal line, the first and 10. He is there. He is the best.
Tuggle and teammates make up the Black Wave, and they should provide many Black Sundays for opponents.
Testaverde back to throw, and there's a fumble in the end zone, and we dive on it. Safety.
Atlanta's defense and special teams constantly attack. They take their chances and see what happens, which is exactly how Jerry Glanville thinks the game should be played.
What I ask the team to do, and this may shock some fans out there, we really don't ask them to win a football game. We play as hard as we can play. And we don't leave any "I wish I had" on the field. "I wish I'd done this," if I'd have done this. We leave all that behind us. We play as hard as we can play. And then we'll live with the results. And the bottom line is your team plays hard and they spill their guts.
No one will ever accuse Jerry Glanville's Falcons of not playing hard. They'll spill their guts in 1992 and do whatever it takes to return to the playoffs. The Atlanta Falcons won 11 games last year, but they're looking to the future. They have higher goals set, and if they keep the faith, their spirit could carry them a long way.
Game day, what's inside you, let it come out, brother. Let the spirit live. And the spirit of our football is what makes our team something special.
For the last 2 years, middle linebacker Jesse Tuggle has led the NFL in tackles. But you know, solid play at the middle linebacker position is nothing new for the Falcons. In fact, it dates back to 1966, Atlanta's first year in the league. The heart of the Falcons' first defense was their first draft pick ever, Tommy Nobis, an All-American from the University of Texas. Now, he came into the league at a time when the old American Football League was still in existence. So it's no wonder that this highly sought-after hard hitter was the first player taken in both the AFL and NFL drafts.
In 1966, both the NFL and the AFL made Texas's Tommy Nobis their number one draft choice and the object of an intense courtship. He was enticed by women, wine, and song, but finally wooed and won by the Atlanta Falcons. Number 60 was the epitome of the middle linebacker in the 4-3 defense, policing the run with both a bear hug and a billy club.
Tommy Nobis kind of guy can play in any era on anyone's football team. He was that good. Very smart football player. Tough, strong guy, but very smart player.
You know, I just remember how dominating a football player he was. I remember his speed. For a big guy, I was startled that a guy could make that many plays on the sideline from a middle linebacker position.
He played in the 4-3, had to play the center, and in those days, the center were the big people.
At 240 pounds, he tossed aside guards, tackles, and lead blockers, employing a domino theory that stated, when one falls, everyone falls.
Good lick on somebody is worth a lot. A good lick has got to really mean something to you. That's just something that some people have that, where that means a lot to them, and some people don't. And linebackers, you got to have it.
A lot of people at that time, hey, Tommy Nobis is the number one linebacker going, you know, he just didn't get the recognition.
Nobis went virtually unnoticed for two reasons. First, he played at the same time and same position as Hall of Fame middle linebacker Dick Butkus. And second, he played for the Falcons. Birds who flew south for the winter, a team whose play did not inspire their flock. The Falcons managed only two winning seasons in Nobis's 12 years, and neither players nor fans could hide from the horror show. The offense couldn't catch, and the defense couldn't tackle. In fact, the only one who had a firm grasp on the nightmarish situation was Tommy Nobis.
I would lay in bed thinking about, gosh, do I really want to do this? Because there's a heck of a price to play. You've got to really have that drive and that want to pay the price. I'm talking about those with the attitude to do it right. Ask yourself the question, do you really want to do this? And if the answer is yes, then let's go to work and do it.
On the worst, he played at his best. But his all-out aggressive style punished not only opponents, but himself. And a finely tuned tackling machine became a wreck for the scrap heap.
I still had a desire to play the game, but my old body and my legs weren't able to do really what I needed to do to be a good player in the National Football League. you're sitting there watching a film, and all of a sudden, the latter part of my career, I started seeing I wasn't getting to the play that I should have gotten to, or that I got to maybe 4 or 5 years earlier.
I think if he'd have stayed healthy, that he's a guy that could have had an impact on this game, maybe along the lines of a Dick Butkus. He was that good.
Recognized as one of the best was a goal that I had. I just didn't want to be another player. I wanted to be something special, and that was a drive that I had. And again, I had pride in that, in trying to establish myself as someone that people would remember as playing in the league.
Unless you've been a Falcons fan since their inception in 1966, you probably don't know much about Junior Coffey. Coffey was a rookie running back in 1965 with the world champion Green Bay Packers. But the following year, he went to Atlanta. He was the Falcons' first ever most valuable player, and he led them in rushing in 1966 and 1967. And he probably would have gone on to be one of the greatest runners in Falcon history had not a knee injury cut his career tragically short. Today, Junior Coffey is far removed from the football field, but he's still working with some of the greatest competitors on the planet. And like Junior in his prime, once these guys get going, they're pretty tough to catch.
Like any racetrack in North America, the action that takes place in the afternoons at Long Acres is the direct result of the hard work and preparation that goes on in the mornings in an area known as the backside. It is here, in a suburb of Seattle, where trainer Junior Coffey overlooks a stable that consists of anywhere from 12 to 20 thoroughbred racehorses. Like many horse trainers, Junior Coffey started at the very bottom to work his way to the top. But what separates him from others is a resume that has football written all over it. In the early 1960s, Junior Coffey was a star running back at the University of Washington. And as an NFL rookie in 1965, he was a member of the world champion Green Bay Packers. But it was with the Atlanta Falcons, then an expansion team, where Junior Coffey's career burst open with the promise of better things to come. In 1966, Coffey was the Falcons' team leader in total yards from scrimmage and in touchdowns scored. He earned Atlanta's very first Most Valuable Player award. But just at the time his football career seemed to be skyrocketing, it suddenly came crashing down to earth. Junior Coffey never got over the effects of a serious knee injury in 1968. Before he reached the age of 30, his football life was over. It was a childhood affinity with horses that brought him back to the state of Washington. At Long Acres, however, the transformation from football star to thoroughbred trainer did not come easy.
Basically, when I came to the track to be a trainer, I didn't bring to the racetrack the idea that I had been in professional sports and someone owed me anything. I did not bring that out of sport. No one was going to give me anything. I had to get out and earn it.
I wasn't worried when Junior retired from football that he would not be able to make the transition from football into so-called a normal life, because I knew he had the horses. It was a passion for him. What I didn't take into consideration was that his life had been planned for him for 12 years. He was told where to go, what time to be there, and all he had to do was show up and perform. So he did have a little bit of trouble in the transition, in that not only did he become his own boss and have to make his own schedule, but he also had employees under him, and that was a little bit hard for him. I think his connection with football has helped him most definitely in his ability to train the animals, in that he knows how his body has responded to different training injuries, and he knows when to press on and when to lay off.
While developing talent is one thing, spotting it is another. In horse racing, The practice of buying a horse out of a particular race in hopes that one can improve its performance is known as claiming. This was the basis for Junior Coffey's greatest racetrack success to date, the rags-to-riches filly named Cruisin' Too Soon.
This was the first horse that we claimed, and he spotted the horse and said that she wasn't particularly good-looking. Her hair wasn't shiny and looked like she could improve under his care, which horses tend to do. And so we claimed this horse for $8,000, and she just kept getting better and better under his care. And we entered her in a stakes race.
Down the lane, Cruisin' Too Soon takes the lead. Then Fire Sweeper in second. Debonair now, she is in third. Mondo Time is fourth. It is Cruisin' Too Soon.
She went off as a kind of a long shot in the stakes race. But she won the race quite easily and ended up winning, I guess, six in a row. And was probably the greatest claim in the history of this racetrack. It was Junior Coffey.
I was on a world championship team with the Packers. Yes, I was excited when we won it, but I won stake races and I don't sleep for two or three days afterwards. I won races and the next morning, 4 o'clock, I'm up. I can't wait to get to the barn to give that horse a little bit of pat on the head or something of that nature. So with me, there's no comparison in winning races here or anywhere, and then winning a football game or scoring a touchdown.
Junior Coffey did indeed make the transition from star running back to a trainer of four-legged runners. And in some respects, the cheering still goes on, particularly when the hard work in the morning breeds success in the afternoon.
I feel very fortunate to the fact that I was able to readjust and realize that life must go on afterwards.
Oh, don't finish, I think you got it.
I had a wife that was able to stand by me and help me through a lot of tough times, and now we are happy, and I'm happy in what I'm doing, and I just hope that success continues.
All you can do is your best. Give it your blood, sweat, and heart.
Good.